I will be talking about the fundamentals and recent advances in transmission electron microscopy. So indeed, I am a research professor, a tenure track research professor at the Faculty of Applied Engineering in the University of Antwerp. And in fact, I do my research within two groups. The electron microscopy group in Antwerp, which is called Electron Microscopy for Material Research, EMAT, where we have 7 professors and 2 associate professors, 22 postdocs, 30 PhD students, almost approximately, and 7 ATP members. As you can see here, this group, which, as I said, is the biggest microscopy group in Belgium. There are 6 transmission electron microscopes, 3 of them being also aberration corrected. And the very recent microscope is also the very recent Titan Themis Z, as it's called, where you can do very precise spectroscopy, but also you can have special resolution in stem mode as low as 100 picometer, even at 60 kV, so at very low acceleration voltages, which, as we're going to see also later, for materials like quantum dots, this is very important and very helpful sometimes, because high acceleration voltages can be very difficult, they can damage the materials. Apart from the 3 aberration corrected microscopes, there are also 2 non-corrected microscopes and also 2 scanning electron microscopes, which I guess some of you would know what you can do with an SEM, one of them also being an environmental SEM, and also a dual beam system, which, as we're going to see later, is used for making thin samples for TEM investigations. And the other group I'm working at is called Applied Electrochemistry and Catalysis Group, ELCAT, is also at the same university. And this group focuses on electrocatalysis, electrochemistry in general, and also reactor engineering. All right, let's go to the first part of my talk, which will be a general introduction about nanotechnology and, of course, TEM. So indeed, nowadays, we have heard quite a lot about nanotechnology. And in fact, we hear it in many aspects and many different applications in life. And if we look for a term about nanotechnology, we will see that the simple term is the following: making nanoscale materials and measuring their unique properties. For the first part of this term, the making nanoscale materials, indeed, we have seen that the last years, nanotechnology have revolutionized many different fields, such as in material sciences, where we have nanomaterials, in electronics, where we have now nanoelectronics, so the size of the devices is becoming less and less. And also very important in the medical sector, where we discuss about nanomedicine, or even for controlled drug delivery and so on, in pharmaceutics. Just to understand the importance of nanotechnology, here I have a graph which I found, and you can see the increasing trend of funding in US dollar, in US million dollars for nanotechnology, whereas, as you can see, it really goes very high from almost the beginning of this era, 2000 up to 2015, so which is already a few years ago from now. Of course, this is a very, let's say, relative application of nanotechnology, and this is with the quantum dots, which you know very well that these semiconductor nanoparticles, depending on their size, when we illuminate them with a UV light, we can have emission of different colors. And this is happened because of course, the emerge of nanotechnology and the tools that we have nowadays. All right, of course, if you remember about the term about nanotechnology, the first one, as we said, is about making nanoscale materials. But as you will see from now on, it is not only important to be able to make nanoscale materials, but it is also very important to be able to measure their unique properties at this nanometer scale, at this very small scale. And in order to do that, we have to use advanced tools. Let's see why this is important. So here I have a scale where you can see different objects. And when we go from left to right, we're going from bigger to smaller objects. So indeed, here at the left side, the common thing that all these objects have is that we can resolve them with a naked eye. And why? Because the resolution we have is enough in order to be able to see these objects. Now, if we go more to the right side of this scale, like the diameter of a hair, red blood cells, or even big assemblies of nanoparticles, then we cannot see them anymore with a naked eye, and we will need a more advanced tool in order to be able to magnify them. And such a tool can be an optical microscope. This microscope allows us to see these objects because the resolution we can get is enough. Normally, we are using visible light, and the resolution we can get by using such a microscope, it's more or less 200 to 300 nanometers. Now, if we go more to the right, as you can see, nanoparticles, atomic clusters, or even single atoms, then we cannot use such a tool anymore. Now, we have to find more advanced ways, and we have to use different tools in order to go to this atomic scale. And such a tool, it's a machine which is called transmission electron microscope. Here, I show you the main differences of an optical microscope with a transmission electron microscope, or in general, an electron microscope. And as you can see, the main difference is that, first of all, in the first case, we are using light, whereas in the second case of the electron microscope, we are using electrons. Also very important, in an optical microscope, we are using glass lenses to be able to focus the beam, whereas in an electron microscope, we are using electromagnetic lenses. Also very important, an optical microscope can operate in air, whereas a transmission electron microscope can only be operated if we have ultra high vacuum, so 10 to the minus 6, minus 7, or even minus 8 millibars. But of course, a very big difference also with an optical microscope is that in order to be able to do electron microscopy measurements is that we need to have very, very thin samples. And thin means most of the cases, depending also on the work we want to do, less than 100 nanometers. Because as we said, we go to this nanometer scale. And if you check, normally a nanomaterial should have at least one of its dimensions less than 100 nanometers. And this is what also we want to achieve here, to be able to look at the nanomaterials at a very local atomic scale. If we have nanoparticles, which are normally like also quantum dots in a solution, then what we do is we take with such a pipette part of the solution, which can deposit on a specialized TEM grid, almost 3 millimeter diameter. And then normally this is covered by a carbon support where we can deposit our particles, we can put it in the microscope with using such a specialized TEM holder. And you can insert this holder inside the ultra high vacuum of the microscope and you can do the investigations. Also, if you have powders, we can just crush them, disperse them in some solvent like ethanol, water, or whatever else, acetone, and then we can also do the same approach. Of course, in some cases, we may also have bulk materials where crushing doesn't work. And in such cases, we have different approaches, such as the use of argon milling, where by using argon ions, we can mill down the material to very small sizes. Or we can also use the so-called focused ion beam, where instead of argon, we are using gallium ions, which can be used to thin the material at these desired dimensions of almost, of less than 100 nanometers. And this is how such a material would look like. So this is an example of a multi-layered film. So here is a substrate, then we have some buffer layer, then this is the thin film, and then also some protection layer for the gallium ions, where as you can see now, this is in cross-section, we can very clearly see a very thin lamella which can be used for further TEM investigations. This is how the very first transmission electron microscope looks like. So this was a very quite small, let's say, equipment. And it was built by Ernst Ruska and Max Knoll back to the 1931, so almost 90 years ago. And in fact, this microscope was just made in order to magnify objects. Because almost at that also period, it was shown that electrons have a dual nature, can act as waves or as particles. And then by having this wave nature also, they had the idea of building this transmission electron microscope. And the spatial resolution at that moment was already a lot better, so 2 times better than that of the optical microscope. It was 100 nanometers. But of course, when an electron beam interacts with a specimen, we have the generation of many, many different types of signals. As you can see, we can have X-rays, backscattered electrons, and secondary electrons, which are usually used from the scanning electron microscope, light. And of course, very important, in a transmission electron microscope, as you can see here, we also have diffracted beams. So we have transmitted electrons. And this can be used for structural investigations, but also for spectroscopy. This is how a transmission electron microscope looks nowadays. Of course, I know it looks like just a box, but if you look inside, we have a very powerful tool. This box is just used to minimize aberrations and vibrations from the outside environment. And as you can see nowadays, we can have spatial resolution of almost 50 picometers, both in TEM and STEM mode. We're going to see later what are these modes. We can get energy resolution of less than 100 mEV. We have very high brightness GANs, spatial resolution, even 80 kV, we're going to see later, is very important, of up to one angstrom. We also have a B-prism, so we can do holography, picometer precision. We can also do electron diffraction, spectroscopy, cathode luminescence, and also very important, especially nowadays, with the current situation of working from home and so on, you can also operate the microscope remotely. Because up to a few years ago, you should be in the microscope room in order to be able to operate this tool. Nowadays, you can just insert your sample, you can sit at home, and you can operate even from there or from a room outside the microscope, the machine, and you can get your results and all the analysis. All right, let's see what type of 2D information can we obtain by a TEM. If you remember, just a few slides ago, I showed you this graph, so this scheme, where you can see what types of signals can we get from an interaction of the electron beam with the specimen. And let's go to the very basic, let's say, use of an electron microscope, which is for by using these elastically scattered electrons in order to do TEM and electron diffraction. A few things about how this works. So normally we have the specimen and the electron beam comes and interacts with the specimen. And then below the specimen, in fact, we have a lens, which is called objective lens and is very important in the transmission electron microscope, where at the back focal plane, we have the formation of a diffraction pattern. Now, if our magnifying lens is focused at the back focal plane, we can get such a diffraction pattern. So very important information about the structure of the material. And if the magnifying lens is focused at the image plane, then we can just get an image of the structure under investigation. And this is very important and very easy. Just by pressing one knob, you can get this, just by one knob in 1 second, either in diffraction mode or in image mode. And here I have an example of a Syria nanopowder, where, as you can see, just by inserting the sample at the microscope, these are tiny nanoparticles or 5 to 10 nanometers, we can get an image of how do they look like. Also, we can get some information about the facet, facets present, which are very important for catalytic applications. And just by pressing one single knob, we can also get this diffraction pattern. So at the same time, we can get both an image, but also a diffraction pattern, something which would you normally do by using, for instance, two techniques, X-ray diffraction and SEM. Of course, the very good thing with a transmission electron microscope is that we can go at very high magnifications, and it gives us also very strong resolution, very good resolution. And if we go at higher magnifications, we can get such images, and this is a high resolution TEM image of a gold nanoparticle deposited on a carbon support. As you can see here, we have these dots that can be atoms or atomic columns. We're going to see later what are those. But of course, a problem that we have normally with a microscope is that due to the fact that we have a lot of aberrations, electromagnetic lessons, like also the glance lenses, are never perfect, and we have aberrations. And due to these aberrations, like spherical aberration, chromatic aberration, and so on, we have contrast delocalization and different types of artifacts. Like, for instance, here, we cannot really see very clear where the interface between the carbon support and the surface of the nanoparticle is. Nowadays, and mostly for the last almost 10 to 15 years, we had the emergence of aberration correctors. And these are parts which can be mounted, let's say a whole optical system, which is normally mounted at the TEM column. And you can have correction of the aberrations. And if we use such an aberration, then you can see that a similar particle can look like that. So you see a very clear image where no spherical aberration is present. We can see very clear surface of the nanoparticle and also the facets of the nanoparticle. But of course, for TEM, since this is a phase contrast image, we can never be sure if we are looking at vacuum here, or we cannot be sure if those white spots are atomic columns or just vacuum. Because as you can see, by changing the defocus value, we can have either dark or white contrast. And so that means that we have to be very careful when we interpret such high resolution TEM images. And normally, what is recommended and is normally best to do is to also do image simulations. So you can put the structure of the material, the software, and also so the lattice spacing, all the angles and so on, but also your spherical aberration coefficient, your defocus value, and then you can get different by changing the defocus value and all these parameters, you can get different possibilities, which you can compare with your own images, and you can see if these are columns or not, and make, let's say, precise investigations of the structure. In order to avoid all this, the last years, we had the emergence of a different technique, which is called scanning transmission electron microscopy. This technique is a bit different than TEM. Of course, it's a different mode at the same microscope, where instead of having a parallel beam of electrons, a static parallel beam of electrons interacting with a specimen, and then we can have an image or a diffraction pattern, now we have a convergent electron beam which scans over the specimen, similar to what happens with a scanning electron microscope. And then detectors, annular detectors, which are located below the sample at a certain distance, can collect electrons which are scattered at different angles. As you can see, we can have different types of detectors, such as a bright field detector, which collects the low scattered electrons, an annular dark field detector, which collects electrons scattered at lower angles, and also an high angle annular dark field detector, which collects electrons scattered at very large angles. So electrons which are scattered according to Rutherford scattering. And the very cool thing with this technique is that the intensity of the form images is proportional to the square atomic number of the structure under investigation. And this is important because normally in an image, a heavier material, like for instance, gold or lead, will look brighter compared to lighter materials, which can be carbon or something else, zinc and so on. And just to understand the difference, this is how and gold nanoparticle would look like in TEM, high resolution TEM, and this is how a similar gold nanoparticle would look like in STEM. Here in STEM, we have directly interpretable images. So this is the gold nanoparticle, which looks very bright compared to the carbon support, which is a lot lighter. And also, as you can see here, we can see the atomic columns, and here we don't have any issues with focusing. Just one focal position can give you a sharp high resolution image, and then you can see the atomic columns of gold or atoms of gold inside this nanoparticle. Just to understand the importance of this technique, here I have an example of an LTA zeolite. So these zeolites are crystalline silicon-based material, silicon aluminum-based material, where normally you can also have cations in the structure. And this is a silver exchanged LTA zeolite, where, as you can see, by doing high-resolution TEM, you cannot be sure where silver is located in the structure. Now, if we use high-resolution STEM, since silver is a lot heavier than carbon, and of course silicon, aluminum, and oxygen in the structure, we look darker. We look brighter in the image compared to the framework species and the vacuum. And the carbon support. And in this way, we can identify the position of silver, and we can make sure where it's located inside the structure, which is very important. But of course, as I said, with TEM, we have to be very careful because, as you can see from this movie that I have here, for such beam sensitive material like a zeolite, after one scan, even at low doses, we can have a complete destruction of the framework. And then we have silver nanoparticles forming, and that means that we lose the structure and also the information that we need. So that's why it's very important to be able to be flexible with acceleration voltages. And normally for such materials, we either go very low, like 60 kV, or even nowadays, even 30 kV. Of course, in such cases, we have to have very thin samples to have transmission, or even higher acceleration voltages, but then working with very low doses and even using specialized single electron detection cameras, which by using very low doses, you can still get enough signal. This is another example of a high resolution stem image. And this is from cadmium selenide nanoparticles, which form these honeycomb structures. And as you can see here, we can very clearly see how these cadmium selenide nanoparticles are forming these honeycomb structures. And here, these dark dots are just the carbon support, so the gaps between the nanoparticles in the assembly. But as you remember, again, I go back to this scheme, and you can see we also have different types of signals. And as you can see here, we also have X-rays, but also inelastically scattered electrons. And as we will see, this can be used for spectroscopy. And the first type of spectroscopy that we can do by collecting X-rays is the so-called energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy. So normally in a TEM tool, we have such a detector, which is located at a certain angle with respect to the to the holder, let's say, which has the which holds the structure, that's all the material we investigate. And by collective X-rays, which are generated after interaction of the electron beam with a specimen, we can have such a spectrum. So and these peaks are characteristic for different materials. So for instance here, this is an example of gold silver core cell nanoparticle, and when we start scanning with the electron beam, so we immediately see peaks of gold silver appearing, and copper of course is from a copper grid we use. So and these peaks are characteristic from the different materials that are present in a specific sample. And of course, very important with a stem, since we can do scanning at different positions in the particle, in the on the sample, then that means that for each pixel that we scan, we can get a spectrum. And if we take all these different pixels, and we plot them, then we're gonna get such a 2D EDX map where we can see the distribution of gold and silver in this case in the nanoparticle. Now imagine that the same electron from the incoming electron beam, which was responsible for the generation of an X-ray after interaction of the sample under investigation, also lost part of its energy. And this same electron can travel through the column and be collected by a different spectrometer, which is normally, as you can see here, at the end of the column. And then by collecting such electrons can be used from this technique, which is called electron energy loss spectroscopy. This is sometimes a bit more powerful than in EDX because you can also get more information. Because you can have information about the electronic structure. Also, you can see, as we're gonna see later, surface plasmon, also information about valency and so on. And this is how such a spectrum would look like. So at the y-axis, we have the intensity in arbitrary units, the counts, and then in the x-axis, we have the energy loss in EV. And for instance here, for this specific nanoparticle, which is made by cobalt and iron, you can see that after interacting with a specimen, the electron beam, then we have electrons which lost a specific amount of their energy. And by plotting that, we can have the peaks of iron and cobalt, which you can see in the spectrum. And of course, very important for this case is that the energy resolution is a lot better than that of EDX. But still, we have always we have some advantages and disadvantages when we compare the two techniques. For example, this technique ILS is more adequate for low loss, for low Z materials, whereas EDX is better for high Z, like lead, gold, and so on. As I said before, by using ILS and by also having a monochromator, which the microscopes at EMAT are equipped with, the aberration corrected microscopes, we can get a lot better and a lot better energy resolution, and we can get information about the fine structure. And for instance, here, for this example of manganese oxide crystals, we can see that by having this different valency, here we have 2+, a mixture of 2+ and 3+, 3+, 4+, and so on, we have different peaks for manganese, but also for oxygen. And from the fine structure, we can identify which type of valency do we have and which type of structure. And also in an aberration-corrected microscope, since we can also get high-resolution images and we can probe materials at the atomic scale, we can combine that with a spatial resolution. And as you can see from this example, that we have a manganese-3 oxygen-4 nanocrystal, by orienting this crystal along a specific zone axis, we can get atomic columns of both manganese-2+ and 3+, where we can plot them and we can get a map of the distribution of the columns in 2D. This is another example of a Syrian nanoparticle, where again, by using ILS, we could get a map and we can see that we have 4+ in the middle of the particle and 3+ at the surface of the nanoparticle, which is quite expected for such nanoparticles of Syria. And of course, as I said before, by going to the atomic scale, we can also see how many of these atomic layers are 3+, and then we can see the transition to the 4+, which is more to the bulk side of the nanoparticle. Now, if we go to more to the low loss and even to the zero loss, so here this peak is from the electrons that lost no, they didn't lose any energy after interaction with a specimen. We can see that close by, so at these low losses, like less than half EV or one EV and so on, we have these bumps. And in fact, we see these bumps for metallic nanoparticles. And these bumps, as you can see here, are because of plasmons. And you can see that we can plot these plasmons. And this is an example for gold, silver, core cell, long nanorods. And we can have a distribution of the plasmonic field around the nanoparticles. And this is only can be achieved by having a monochromator and also by having an ILS spectrometer. Very important also with the use of STEM is that we can also do quantification, which, as you will see later, is very important, and we always focus on quantification. By having such images, by using atom counting and statistical parameter estimation theory, and this is the specialization of Professor Sandra Van Aert at EMAT, we can determine the number of atoms at each atomic column. And by having this information, we can be sure what is the number of atoms at each atomic column. And of course, as you will see later in the presentation, we can also do some 3D studies and so on. Just this is an example of the use of STEM images and atom counting. So these are atomic clusters. These are clusters of gold of almost 20 atoms. And as you can see, under the electron beam, they are not stable. As you can see, they are changing all the times. And as you can see here, they're deposited on a carbon support, and you can see the single atoms flying around. Of course, this is because of the interaction with the electron beam. And what we did here is that we acquired fast images along different, from same nanoparticles, from same clusters at different times. And then by doing atom counting, we were able to determine the number of atoms at each position. And by doing that for different particles and different frames, we would get some statistics and show that the average number is 20 ± 1 atoms, which is very important because this is what was also expected from the collaborators. Of course, here I have different examples. I will just go fast. This is for 32 atoms, for 62 atoms, or even bigger. This is a nanoparticle now for 500 atoms. And we see again that we get very precise results about the number of atoms in the nanoparticles. This is an example of the use of the technique, the combination of the approach, STEM and atom counting, and statistical parameter estimation theory on indium zinc phosphide quantum dots, where by just having such images, we were able to measure the distances between the atomic columns. And by having the particles, the quantum dots before and after the addition or the incorporation of zinc in the structure, we could see differences in the lattice spacing. And this could be explained here because zinc is normally a smaller atom than indium, and normally we would expect some lattice contraction. Nowadays, there is also a different technique which was developed recently and which can be used in a STEM, and this is called DPC, so differential phase contrast. I'm not going to go to the details, but I just wanted to show you a few examples. So by having this technique, we use a different detector, a segmented detector, and DPC measures the displacement of the center of mass of a convergent beam electron diffraction pattern during STEM. And as you can see, here I have an example of a battery cathode material, lithium manganese oxide, where from an HADF STEM image, if you remember, I told you, heavy elements will look brighter than lighter ones. And along this zone axis, we have manganese. These are the dumbbells forming a manganese. And here in between, we don't have magnesium, but we expect to have oxygen and lithium. By using DPC, we can see that now we can very clearly see the atomic columns or the atomic layers of lithium and also the oxygens which are here below the transition metal layers. And if we get a more close-up image and we also overlay the model from XRD, you can see that indeed we can see here from HADF STEM only the heavy elements, so the transition metals, and then lithium, which is a very light element, and also oxygen, we can now clearly see in IDPC. So just to wrap up this first part of the presentation, we saw that by using this very powerful tool nowadays, we can get 2D images from different nanoparticles, nanostructures. Also at the same time, just by pressing one knob, we can get diffraction data, spectroscopic data as well. And by combining all these, we can get information like the number of atoms, distribution of elements, type of crystallographic facets, and electronic structure. But very important here, and I wouldn't say a drawback, but a limitation sometimes, is that by using all this, the information we get is 2D. And here I have an example to show for you to understand that 2D is not always good. So here, as you can see, we have the shadows of here at the left, you can see something like a man, and here at the right, a robot. And this is just here, normally we have something which you cannot see for the moment. And by projecting light, we can see the shadows of these two objects. Now, if I show you what makes these two shadows, I'm almost sure that nobody would expect is just a bunch of metallic and wooden parts. So as you can see from this very simple example, two-dimensional projections of a three-dimensional object can sometimes be very misleading. And the same also goes at the nanoscale. And if I show you this image, where you can see we have a substrate of manganese, of magnesium oxide, and then we have a gold nanoparticle on top, here we can kind of clearly see the interface and so on. But if somebody asks, how many atoms do we have here? Or if this is a single layer, or if this is a real nanoparticle, or maybe just a layer of atoms, we cannot be sure, because from such images, we cannot get any 3D information. So we cannot get any information along the Z axis somehow. In order to be able to obtain such information, we have to find ways to go from 2D to 3D. And such a way is the use of electron tomography. This is a specialization of Professor Sarah Balz at EMAT. And as you can see in electron tomography, we have just a nanoparticle or a nanostructure under investigation, which we deposited on a specialized TEM holder. And such holders can tilt inside the electron microscope over a wide tilt range, normally between plus minus 80 degrees. And we can acquire images every 2 degrees. Like also what would you do in a CT scan and so on. The outcome of this approach can be used, so the tilt series of these projections can be used as an input for a mathematical algorithm, and then we can get 3D information. So here you can see the volume of the nanoparticle, but also you can see, maybe I can play it again so you can see it. We can also see, it will come in a second, that we can get slices through the volume. And by having, you can see them here, slices through the volume, we can see later that we can use them for quantification. Just to understand the importance of electron tomography in TEM, here I have an example of a porous material where we have also copper tiny nanoparticles. And for this specific material, this is an SBO porous structure. The question was whether we have these copper nanoparticles inside or at the surface of the material. And this is very important information because by having them either in or outside at the surface, also the properties change dramatically. And of course, such information cannot be obtained by just looking at such 2D images. So by acquiring a tilt series and by reconstructing, we can see that indeed, most of the particles are located outside, but also we have, as you can see here from the ortho slices, particles which are located inside the pores of the SPO structure. And this is very important information. This is the example that I showed you earlier, if you remember in my slides, of this cadmium selenide. And also here, there is another example for lead selenide nanoparticles, which are assembled and then making these honeycomb structures. And by looking at these images, I'm quite sure you expect them to have next to each other and they create this kind of graphene type of arrangement. However, by applying electron tomography, we were able to see that we don't have a single layer of nanoparticles, but as you can see from the ortho slices, we have two layers on top of each other with a slight shear between them. And this means that we don't have a graphene type of structure, but a silicene type of structure. And this was a very important observation. Also here, you can see from the other direction, the two layers on top of each other. This is very important because the properties of the materials change when we have two layers on top of each other. And by having, of course, this information, we could do further quantification and we could determine the angle between the particles, the bonding, so the length of the bonding between them, and also quantify the distances and so on. Also very important for porous materials is that by acquiring such series, we can also get information about porosity and do and acquire also, of course, more data for statistical analysis and so on. But as I said, tomography is nice and you can give information in 3D, like also shape of nanoparticles, or about if particles are present in the structure and so on. But we also need to get numbers. And this is the ultimate goal of an electron tomography experiment, to be able to perform quantification. This is an example of the gold particle that I show you in one of my first slides. And as you can see here, we can see very clear that we have a kind of a pentatwin nanoparticle. You see here the different twins, but of course we can never be sure about how many atoms we have there and if this is indeed a nanoparticle. By acquiring a series at the atomic scale now, so high resolution images, we can get a reconstruction like that. And here I want you to focus that this is not a model made in a PC, but this is the reconstruction made by acquiring high resolution tilt series at the electron microscope. We reconstruct it. And as you can see also from the ortho slices, we can see the individual atoms in the structure. And by having this, we can do further quantification. And we can also see the strain we have maybe in the middle of close to the twins, also the surface of the nanoparticle, so on. So this is a real experimental 3D data and not an experimental and not a theoretical model. And this can only be achieved by acquiring high resolution tomography series in an aberration corrected microscope. Of course, if you remember, I told you that also with a TEM, you can do spectroscopy. And in fact, nowadays, instead of having one detector, which allows us to collect enough X-rays at specific tint angles, now we have four detectors symmetrically arranged around the specimen, which can collect X-rays at different tilt angles. And by collecting, for instance, for these nanoparticles that I have here, these hollow gold-silver nanoparticles, you can collect X-ray EDX maps. So you can collect X-ray signal at different tilt angles from minus 80 to plus 80 degrees. So instead of having STEM images as an input for the reconstruction algorithm, you can use 2D EDX maps. And by combining all those, you can perform a three-dimensional elemental analysis and compositional analysis, Whereas you can see in the beginning for these particles, which also were used for a galvanic displacement, we have gold surrounding silver. Then at the second step, we have more silver and gold becomes more towards the particle, and also we becomes hollow. At the end of the galvanic displacement approach, you have more silver outside and gold makes this kind of hollow structure inside. And these are very important because, as you can see here, for instance, we have this intermediate step that you have a combination, so an alloy of gold and silver, which wouldn't be possible to see just from 2D EDX maps. Also, if you remember one of my first slides, I show you this example of a Sirian nanoparticle, where you could see that at the surface we have 3+. Now, if we acquire such maps along different tilt angles, by using also the monochromator, by using ILS, we can obtain, first of all, a reconstruction of the shape of the nanoparticle. You see, this is like an octahedral nanoparticle. And also very important, we can get distribution of 3+ and 4+ in the nanoparticle. You can see the core is 4+, and then we have a surface of 3+ around. But of course, this, somebody can say, okay, very cool, but what does it give me as an extra information? And you can see that if we get the ortho slices, if we look at the ortho slices through the maps, we can see that for such nanoparticles with this octahedral shape, we can see that we have mostly 1-1-1 facets, and we have Syria 3+ symmetrically around the bulk part. Whereas for such type of particles that we have also 1-0-0 facets, we see that we have an excess of 3+ at the surface. And this is very important information because for catalysis, maybe this is very important because it has been shown that for Syria specifically, these specific facets show a better catalytic activity for different catalytic reactions. Of course, nanomaterials normally change, and nanomaterials are not used just, let's say, they are not made just to be investigated in the microscope. Normally, they are used in real applications, like in catalytic applications, and in real applications, the nanomaterials change. And they change morphology and size, also the structure may change, the cell thickness in core cell nanoparticles can change, alloying between the core and the cell, also quality of alloying can be modified, but also we can start having defects. And this is very important to be able to analyze and see what happens after a catalytic reaction or if different applications. And this is what, this is an example of what had been, what researchers had been doing all these years. So this is an example of a platinum nanodendrite, where these platinum dendrites are used for the oxygen reduction reaction. And it was shown that after cycling, the activity was reduced towards this specific reaction. And what we did in the group was to get these platinum dendrites before and after catalytic cycling. We did tomography measurements. We were able to see how the structure looks like and also obtain information about porosity. And we realized that after cycling, the porosity decreased. And this could be the reason why, this could explain why also the catalytic activity was shown from different techniques that was decreasing after cycling due to the loss of porosity. Because you know that for catalysis specifically, the surface is very important. And if you lose porosity, surface is also reduced and then catalytic activity may be reduced as well. And also another technique, which is called identical location TEM, similar. You can get your TEM grid. You can put it in the microscope. You can see how the particles look like, even with the spectroscopy or just imaging. Then you go back to your reactor, you do the reaction, and then you remember where the particles were located in the grid. And so you can investigate them and see how did they change the composition, but also the the shape, size, and so on, and the structure. But of course, as you can see from this example, particles change. So the changes do not happen out of a sudden, but change over time. And as you can see here, this is a gold nanoparticle on a Syria support, where you can see in vacuum conditions, in the TEM and room temperature, we see no change at the surface. Whereas now the same nanoparticle, if we start flow oxygen and we also increase the temperature to 300 Celsius, we see here that the surface is very active. And it would be very nice if we are able to investigate those changes while happening. And that is what brings us to the in situ TM experiments, which is also the last part of my talk, where I will give you some recent advances on this field. Normally in the group, there are many in situ holders available, like this gas heating holder, also the climate holder, the gas heating holder, also a liquid holder we're going to see later, heating holders, also strain, and so on. And this is some examples of the use of such holders. So here at the left, you can see a gold nano dumbbell, which was heated in situ from room temperature up to 300 degrees Celsius. And as you can see, by using the approach that I discussed about before, atom counting and the statistical parameter estimation theory, we were able to detect here at the tip the number of atoms in each atomic column. And also we could plot them in 3D. We can also see by the model we obtained the facets. And then after heating, we saw that it became more like a rod. We did the same. We could quantify the shape of the particle. And we saw also that the particle changed shape, but also structure. And also another example, it's shown here, which this gold nanostar was heated from room temperature up to 900 Celsius. And by acquiring tomography series, a different step of heating, we could see how the fine tips of these plasmonic nanoparticles were reduced, and now you have them flat. And we see that by changing temperature, this becomes more flat and opposed. Of course, the plasmonic properties change as well. This is also another example where heating was combined with spectroscopy. And for this core cell gold-silver nanoparticle, nanorod, in the beginning, we would just acquire a tomo series where you could get distribution of gold and silver in 3D. And then temperature was raised from room temperature up to 450 Celsius. And heating was done in segments. For first, heated 60 seconds, stop heating, acquire the tilt series, quantify. As you can see, a bit of alloying starts appearing here at the surface. Then the same particle was heated now for 60 more seconds at 450, again a tomo series, and by doing that 10 times until we achieve 300 seconds, we could see that at the end, we could get a complete alloyed nanorod, and we could see how this alloying was happening at different step of this in situ heating. Nowadays also, as I told you, we have more advanced tools where instead of just doing heating or cooling or just biasing, you can combine also a gas flow, but also heating. And for instance, by using such a system, which you can see here, now we don't have a simple holder that we just deposit a TM grid, but here at the tip of the holder, we have a nanoreactor, which as you can see, it's made by two silicon nitride supports on top of each other. And with also using this O-ring and by assembling the reactor, we can have a place that we can do reactions. If you remember, I told you that normally the microscope of column operates at ultra high vacuum. So if we were flowing any gas, we would just break the vacuum and we wouldn't be able to do anything or even see any electrons coming through. Whereas now by having this nanoreactor, we can shield the vacuum of the microscope from the reactor. And then here we can flow gases and use pressures up to 1 bar. And also we can increase the temperature. As you can see, we can test, we can use different types of gases like carbon monoxide, helium, air or so. And what people would do up to now is just to use such holders and then by using 2D TM imaging. And unfortunately, yeah, the problem with such holders is that you cannot tilt very high, up to plus minus 20 degrees. And that means that you cannot do tomography. So what people do is researchers acquire 2D images. And then by using Wolf construction and DFT calculations, they can find equilibrium shapes that can match what we see experimentally. But of course, I have here an example of a platinum nanoparticle, which in projection looks like a square. So normally it would be a cube, but you can see that you can propose many different models for such a cross-section image. And that means that by using that, we cannot always have very precise information. And it would be best to find some quantitative approach to do that. Very recently, we used these nanoparticles, the platinum nanoparticles, where we acquired high-resolution images in the nanoreactor in room temperature and ultra-high vacuum. And by using the statistical parameter estimation and atom counting, we were able to determine the position of the atomic columns and also determine the position, the amount of atoms in each atomic column. And then by getting these counting results, we use them to generate a 3D starting configuration by positioning the atoms in each atomic column parallel to the beam direction and symmetrically around the central plane. And then by means of molecular dynamic simulations that employ the embedded atom method potential, we could obtain a relaxed 3D model of the structure of the nanoparticle. And as you can see here, this is how the model looked like. And again, I say, this is not a theoretical model. This is a model based on the experimental results and the atom counting results. We can see the distribution of the facets in 3D, which also can be used for a later evaluation of the particles. We did the same for the same nanoparticle, a different imaging, a different reaction environments. First, hydrogen flow at 300 Celsius, where we can see we have a change at the shape. Now it becomes more truncated. Then in oxygen becomes more rounded, and then we did this reversibly. So we again flew hydrogen, we can see that again it becomes more like truncated. And then by flowing oxygen again at 300 Celsius, we could again see that we have more rounded shape. And by having this information, we could also quantify the facets and the results. And we could see, as you can see here, that indeed at the hydrogen environment, we have more of these low order facets, whereas for an oxygen environment where we saw it became more spherical, the particle, we have more of these high order index facets, which also could explain this more spherical shape of the nanoparticle. Also, very recently, we have similar holders and systems, but now instead of flowing gases, we can flow liquids. And this is very important for many different applications, like also for batteries or even for catalysis, electrocatalysis, and so on. And at the same time, you can also do biasing. And by having such a holder, you would be able to see electrocatalysis or even electrochemistry in situ. And this is just a recent example of a work which was done with Den Solutions, the provider of that holder, where by just flowing liquid in the holder, and by applying a potential, we were able to grow these copper dendrites in situ. Before I close, I would like to thank all my colleagues for their help to, and also the colleagues, I mean, from my lab, but also from the other labs, the collaborators for making the samples, but also my colleagues for the fruitful discussions we have all these years for these results.